Today I'm going to be the host of this seminar talk. Today we are very happy to invite Dr. Chen. Later he will introduce himself. Right now he's the co-founder of Skywatch, a company. Yeah, basically focused on the artificial intelligence and image processing CPU. Later, Professor Chen. Professor Chen also, you still have class in NTU, right?
Yeah, I'm about to quit. Too much work.
Yeah, he still teach some very advanced course in National Taiwan University. So you are welcome to contact him after this talk if you have any interest in his work. Okay, let's welcome Professor Chen.
Thanks for coming. If you can't hear me in the back, just raise your hand and let me know. Okay, I prefer to not use the microphone. Okay, so anyways, Professor Chen is actually my cousin, elder or younger, you take your guess. But anyways, here's a brief introduction about myself. I got a degree in Taiwan, NTU, Taoyi, and then I went to the States. During the process of my stay in the United States, I did a few projects. We did some VR stuff, okay, in UNC, which is one of the better schools for interactive techniques. I worked in Intel as a consultant, and so we did a project called OpenCV. We started this project so that people can do computer vision stuff a bit easier, and it turned out to be a success. So my guess is that some of you are actually using the library for your own development. I spent a few years in NVIDIA doing GPU stuff, so I think I delivered over a billion units of these GPUs, right, for gaming, for scientific visualization, and recently for AI stuff. Okay. I went to Nokia Research shortly after for doing some computation related research. And then a few years ago, I came back to Taiwan and worked on a few projects. And my current venture is this company called Skywatch, where we're making IoT devices with a bit more intelligence. And there's a new term recently called AIoT, which is IoT with intelligence. Okay. And I'm also a adjunct faculty at the National Taiwan University, where I try to help out in terms of what I've learned before, specifically GPU and computational products. So I'm not going to talk about my company, it's kind of besides the point, but if you're interested about a career option where we do interesting coding and actually deliver products, just come and let me know. So anyways, there are actually two topics today that I can cover. And this is the reprise of a talk that I gave in Academia Sinica, where they had a Taiwan AI, I think, annual conference, right? So this is the first topic, which is about NVIDIA's GPU, right? They sell a lot of these, and a lot of people are using them for training the neural networks and whatnot. And then Google has their own processor called Tensor Processing Units, which is not a product that you can buy, right? TPU is something that they built for themselves, and apparently this is way faster than that, right? So I'm trying to explain why this is the case and how the designs vary between them. And there's a second topic that I talked about basically how you can use these processors to develop your own applications. If you have software like frameworks and things like that, then you can already train a new neural network, and this is probably not that interesting. But if you're developing your own layer of neural network, you may face issues where the driver is not supported and the framework is not supported. For that purpose, you can probably use this new invention that we did. And it's actually an ICCV paper that came out last year. Okay? So my guess is that we're not going to have time to cover this. There's a paper that we wrote, I think right, Actually, I'm not sure where. Anyways, here.
Okay, so there's a paper you could take a look, and it's this title, but basically it's a simple way to write a fast communication algorithm with any kind of process. Okay. So this is a solution that I'm going to talk about. This work is made in conjunction with Professor Chen and soon to be Dr. Lin at Taiwan University. So let me go back and focus on this topic, right? So there's a Godzilla, and there's a, anyway, they're fighting. I'm just saying two giants fighting each other. Okay. But traditionally, these are the two players, right? You got Intel and you have NVIDIA, right? And these are the things they make. As of 3-4 years ago, right? This is about the size in proportion to their actual size, right? The actual size is like this big, right? It's like postage stamp, right? The size of this is probably about 2 centimeter by 2 centimeter. Okay, so it come out to about 400 square meter. Okay, so this is a GPU, and this is a CPU, right? So if you're wondering how you get this picture, right? Just take the chip and take the picture. So this is a picture of the chip. Something to notice is that if you look at it, there are some symmetries here, right? Okay, they're like this block looks like this block, right? They're all similar, right? So this is actually 2 core, I think, and eventually this comes to 8 cores. So there are basically 4 units that can execute instruction in parallel. Okay. Now, what happens is that these designs are largely the same. You just copy and paste, right? And then there's some blue units on the outside where it shuffles the traffic and whatnot, right? And this, on the other hand, is a GPU, right? If you look at it, there's quite a few more of these, and each one of these is a computational core, right? If you look at it, there is like 2,000 of these here, and there's only 8 cores there. Right, so the discrepancy is big, right? There's 2,000 cores here and there's 8 cores there. So the Intel people must be stupid, right? They make huge cores, right? But that's not the case, right? The reason is that, right? If you're building a race car, right, that's designed to go very fast, it's gonna cost a lot of money, right? Money equals to area. Okay? So what Intel is doing is that they're trying to build something like a race car that goes around the circuit very quickly while carrying only one person, okay? Whereas if you have a GPU, right, we're just making a lot of these Beetle, right, little cars. And these cars are not designed to go very fast, right? But they're designed to ship a lot of people, right? So I find this analogy to be kind of useful where if you think about it, if your purpose is to ship a lot of people from one point to the other, right? These kind of transportation vehicles seem to make more sense than a race car, right? So that's the reason why, basically, why you have this kind of discrepancy. 2,000 cores and 8 cores, okay? Now, GPU can do a lot of things, right? For example, you can render pretty pictures for movies, like this, that, and Yoda, right? So if Yoda can fly, right, and that's like quite an achievement. But GPU can also render like really ugly pictures like this. You guys play this? No? Yes? Minecraft? Here's my eye, like, I can look at it. Anyways, rendering is not the point, right? But anyways, GPUs were originally designed for graphics applications. But recently, because we have all these computation, and it's been used to do like play chess, right? And to do things like recognizing objects, right? So this is one of the more famous challenges, open challenges. Have you guys heard of it, ImageNet? Okay, so what they do is that they hire a bunch of people online from Amazon, right?
Amazon has something called mechanical Turk, right? And you can design something like an experiment and ask people questions such as, what's in this picture, right? So a bunch of people will just look at pictures and tag them, say, okay, here's a panda, right? And here's a dog. And if I'm smarter, I would say, okay, this is a golden retriever, things like that. So there are a lot of people who tag these photos, and there's a competition about can you recognize these photos according to the content, right? We know all these tags, just try to come up with the name for each picture, right? So when you do that, it was originally a very difficult problem, right? And recently, because the help of neural networks and GPU, right? The accuracy has been dropping drastically. So if you look at it, but around 2012, people started using GPUs. There are like four entries who are using GPU. And the important thing is that the drop in terms of error rate was very significant, right? For between 2000 and 2010, I think we achieved like a 3% drop. Right, 10 years, 3%, we were stuck, right? I was doing this kind of research during that period of time as well. We were like, okay, we couldn't find a better algorithm to tackle this problem. And around this time, right, some graduate student and his very famous professor, right, just say, okay, let's just do it the stupid way. Right? Let's just throw a lot of computation to it, and we throw a big neural network to it. And we'll just use the neural network we used 20 years ago and make it a bit bigger, right? And it turned out to work wonders, right? That recognition rate increases by 10% just in 1 year, right? By like a little team somewhere in Canada, right? eventually, this accuracy becomes so good, right? I think recently it's about 4%, 3% or 4. And the low 3%, basically, we can claim that machine is doing better than human, right? So this competition actually stopped now because we don't care about this problem anymore. It has become too easy for AI to do it. Okay. So the reason why we can do this is because we have a lot of computation. And the scale of computation we have now compared to like 10 years ago is thousands of times more, mostly because of GPU, right? And we didn't realize that we are sitting on this kind of treasure until recently. Okay? So the key point here is that we have a tool for parallel computation, right? And this is a Chinese saying. Basically, it's called divide and conquer, right? So you divide the problem into smaller ones, and then you destroy your enemy, right, one by one, basically. So there are two steps. First, you need to divide them. Second, you need to solve them individually. Right. So, basically, parallel computation. There are several classes of parallel computation. The first kind is a multiple programming, and this you see a lot, right? You have your multi-threading code, and you have your multitasking on your desktop. And I think this is from Visual Spark, and this is one of the earlier Windows system. And that this basically means that we can have one desktop with multiple programs running, right? So it helps. We use this all the time. But the other bigger problem is that if we have one single program and the program needs to be running very quickly, there are several ways to do it. One of the ways that Intel, for example, decided to tackle the problem was by running several instructions at the same time, right? So I can say, okay, there are three instructions. I like to run them in parallel. But it becomes difficult because these three problem instructions tend to be dependent on each other, right? The second instruction may need output from the first instruction. So this means that usually it's difficult to run many instructions at the same time. So modern parallel computation tend to try to reduce the problem into something called data parallelism, where you already design the problem to be running one instruction with multiple data. Okay. One of the examples is, for example, Cray from maybe, I don't know, 30 years ago. These are super expensive computers that they cost about $3 to $5 million to buy. That's why they came with a real data sofa, because you spend $5 million on this. It better be genuine than the right things. This is used for by places such as the Weather Bureau, right, where they have to predict the weather, right? During the prediction of weather, you divide the space into multiple cells, and then you solve each cell independently, right? So these kinds of problems are well suited for the data parallelism machines. So these used to be super expensive, right? $3 to $5 million, depending on how much money you have. They can sell you a machine with any kind of budget you can think of. You can say, okay, I want to buy a $100 million machine. It would be okay, and then we just build it. But this is too expensive, right? So what we're talking about is, let's look at computer graphics and how it became a fast processor for AI. Okay? So this is a basic graphics pipeline, not yet, right? This is the beginning of a graphics pipeline. Maybe I just use this place. Do you go crazy when I was trying to do this? Their instructions go through something called input processor, and they get processed into something like little triangles. So they are treated as little triangles in this pipeline, right? Why triangles, you might ask, right? Why? So if you're writing a graphics program, why do you have triangles instead of saying like circles? Any idea?
Median mark.
What? Sorry.
Triangle like a median mark.
Okay. No. Not at all. The company hasn't been born yet. So this is from like 30 years ago. Okay. So the company is over like 15 years ago. So the reason it's not working anymore. Okay. Yeah. Anyways. So the reason is that we want to draw surfaces. And how do you define surfaces? Right. When you have surfaces, like curved surfaces, it becomes too difficult to render. So the easiest way to render a surface is to divide them into smaller chunks. Right? The smallest you can divide is triangle. How it works, it's just not kind of the context of it. It's fine, don't worry. So if you have quads, for example, you have it occasionally won't work. So I said, don't worry about it. Sometimes not. Okay. Anyways. So you can have quads, right? Or points. Or surface like this type, right? Right? So why didn't we use tile? Why didn't we use a square? Why not? What?
Bigger than triangle.
That's true. But there must be a guy, right? There must be a guy saying like, okay, triangles are annoying. I like quads. I just build a machine with quads. And I would just make a company and become super rich, right? So this guy never came up, right? Why is that? It's high school math, right? Pretty simple, actually. So I'm not gonna tell you. Okay, so anyways, you have triangles. I'll tell you, anyways. You have 3 points. 3 points gives you a plan, right? 4 points, does it give you a plan? It could be like that, right? So with 4 points, there's no guarantee that all these 4 points are going to be on the same plan. So you cannot use 4 points. You can only use 3 points. If you have 4 points like that, you can divide it in two ways, right? Your triangle could be, your surface could become this or that. And they could be different, right? If these 4 points are not on the same plane, right? So just use triangle. Okay. So triangle will be rotated by this unit. And I'm just going to call it do geometry stuff.
Right? It was rotated and lighted on the corners, and then they will get turned into pixels by this unit. I'm not going to tell you what it does. I'm just going to say it does some pixels, right? The reason that they're turned into pixels is because modern TVs render pixels, right? So television has like a scan line, right? And during the scan, we just scan out the pixels, right? A 60-year-old computer display actually can render lines directly, but it becomes too slow when you have a lot of objects. So we just say, okay, we're just going to render pixels. Right. Now, but you have pixels already on the screen, right? You need to have a way to figure out if this triangle is in front or in the back, right? Right. So I can say I want to render something that's behind this screen. You can see it. So we need to have a way to decide whether we should put this here or throw it away, okay? And this is called the Z buffer. So Z buffer works according to the following. For each pixel on this triangle, say I have this triangle, I will render from my eye to this pixel. I will figure out how far is it from the camera. Okay? And the rendering process basically simulates the process of taking a picture of this triangle. So once I have the Z, right, I can go and use this Z and compare something that's already been rendered on the screen. So there's something called frame buffer. So I would read the Z and decide whether this Z is closer to the camera than the current triangle. Right? If it's closer, I just keep this. If it's farther, I just throw it away. Okay? Very simple. Got it? So instead of having the colors, right, the frame buffer on the screen also stores the distance of each pixel with respect to your eye. Okay? And if you have the distance, you will be able to figure out whether the pixel should be rendered or not. Okay? Right. So this is about 1986, 1990 roughly. Okay? About 1993, right? There are a few companies coming about around, and they say, okay, we want to make something that runs faster. So the easiest way to make it run faster is like this. Add more units, right? That's easy. I can charge you more, right? Just add more units. Now the problem becomes that you have all these little towns here, and you have more and more people living in here, and the highway becomes congested, right? What happens when you have highway that's congested, right? You build bypasses, okay? So this is how we do. This is around, I think, 1995, roughly. People started building connections to the memory directly from each unit, okay? About 20 years ago. And about around 15 years ago, these history units, they started doing more and more things. Like people would say, okay, can you render something like a leather, or like plastic, or like glass, right? And we're like bothered with all these requests. We decided, okay, screw that. We're not going to do any mystery math here. We're just going to turn them into processes. And you will write little programs in here to do the coloring of these pixels, or transformation of these triangles. Make sense? So during 1995 to about 2000, right, we turned these units into little ALUs. They can run little programs up to a few hundred lines. Okay? So before, this is like three lines of code. And around here, it became like 15 to 100 lines of code. Right? And you can write a little program called Shader. Okay? Now, if you look at these become closer, right? These, the functionality of these became closer and closer. And plus, they do about the same thing, right? You get data, you do something, and you output, right? They're basically the same. And then you have one engineer here, and when you have 100 engineers here, you have 100 engineers here, and they're doing the same thing.
So I just fire 100 engineers and get the other 100 to do the same thing, right? That's cheaper, right? That's basically what happened. But do you know which group of engineers they basically fired? Take a guess. So eventually we just say, okay, these two units are the same. We're just gonna do this. It's easy. But we kind of get rid of one of these guys. Okay, which one did we remove, right? Anyways, I'm not gonna tell. It's a trade secret. But anyways, we have one big shader, and we basically build it like that, multi-core. So we bundle these together and make multiple copies of these, and it became more and more scalable, right? So if you look at the first processor that can actually do the AI computation, back in 2008, right? I think I designed part of these and part of these. So these are the processors. These are the distribution units, and these are the bundle. Okay. So if you look at this picture, and then go back to the picture I drew earlier, these are the distributors, and these are the shaders, and then these are the frame buffers, right? So basically the same, right? Like that. So input processor, distribution units, processors, and the bottom, okay? And memory is also here. So this is as of 10 years ago, and this one is as of about 4 years ago, right? If you look at it, there is one core that contains many, many cores. And then you copy and paste four times to get to the chip you wanted. Okay? So you can cut it down into something smaller, but these will stay the same. But you can make it bigger by copying and pasting and build like a big, big, big chip. This one. Okay? So GPUs became basically more programmable because there are so many things people want to do and we don't have time to do it for them, so we just make it into processors. The other thing is that GPUs used to do pixels, and pixels are in agents, right? RGB agents. After a while, people started saying, okay, we need higher resolution pixels. We said, okay, fine, 16 bits, okay? They said, no, we want floating points. So pixels are now floating points. And that means that they're very good for scientific computation, right? And finally, GPU have a lot of memory bandwidth because they need to pull in a lot of data to them and then process them and then output them, right? It used to be the reason of having all these bandwidth originally came about because we want to play games, right? Mm-hmm. So all the gamers want to have good, pretty pictures on the screen, so they read a lot of texture. And then they dump all these pictures out. So there's a lot of demand for high bandwidth, right? So if you look at this, this is actually a good processor for doing a lot of memory intensive, computational intensive computation, right? But it used to be very difficult to program because you have to write a program that draws pictures, right? Writing a program that draws picture requires the use of things like OpenGL, and it's too much to learn, right? And there's all these tricks that you have to do, so it became too difficult. So we built something called CUDA about 10 years ago, roughly. And this is basically something, some term we came up with called compute unified device architecture. But internally, we just call this compute. Basically, we built a infrastructure inside of the GPU and inside of the driver that allows you to do computation, right? And this computation also allows you to write program almost like a C program. And we also did something called a MVCC compiler, which allows you to write a C-like program and just compile that, you know, like that, right? You just say MVCC and compile something that's very similar to C, and then it automatically runs on the GPU, right? So we built this because, you know, we didn't know what else to do, you know, because there's all these computation and we want to leverage them, but in a sense, we don't know who will be using them, right? So we build this thing called Google. But turned out, they're very useful for a lot of applications. Originally, it's parallel computation, and then you have these professors who want to buy fast processors, and we just sell these to them, right? But recently, more recently, is all these AI need, and maybe you know Bitcoin mining and all that, that requires a lot of these kind of parallel computation. So, as a result, and the stock price just goes way up. There's Nvidia, there's Intel, and they're not growing so much, and the stock I used to own, I still own, grew up a lot, right? And this was as of 2017, and I think they grew even more recently, like doubled again. If you look at this picture, right, and then you look at another picture, this is the processing performance, right? The picture is kind of sort of looks similar, right? Stock price, flops, you know, similar. Anyways, there's one thing I'd like to point out, right? So there's a drop here, right? Okay, I'm extrapolating the performance here, and the little drop here indicates the company screwed up a little bit. Okay, we're not executing as quickly, but anyways, they catch up here, so that's good. That's one thing. The other thing is, if you look at it, this curve looks like it's growing at s to the power of square, you know, something like that. That's the processor. But if you look at memory, you know, that's the way you screw up big time here, but if you look at it, it's very linear. So memory bandwidth is growing at a linear pace, whereas the computation is growing at super linear pace. You know why? Because memory people sucks? I know why, but I'm not gonna tell you. I can tell you, but maybe after the class. But anyways, the implication of this is that your memory bandwidth is not going to be enough, regardless of what you do, right? Because there's a lot of hierarchy here to support this. In CPU, you have register cache that gives you the memory, right? But in GPU, it looks like this. It's a huge mess, right? You have all these processors, and you have some memory, and then you have some cache, and then you have some memory, right? And they need to be routed to the correct processor. So this routing here is already complicated enough, right? This bandwidth isn't sufficient to support all these processors. That's the second problem. Right? The first problem is how do you deliver data to the correct processor? It's a huge problem. But anyways, here are a few numbers. We have something called CGMA, which is the number of memory access you can permit per access, how many computations you can do. Right? So say we fetch one memory, and how many cycles do we have to compute before we can fetch the next memory, right? The higher number indicates slower memory, right? So if you look at this from 2006, right, the total bandwidth is about 86 gigabytes per second. So in sort of layman's term, right, this bandwidth will be able to get my entire hard drive out in 6 seconds, okay? Like I have like 500 gigabytes on my laptop, and GPU can get 86 gigabytes per second. So that's really, really fast, right? But if you look at 4 years ago, this number grew to 200, which means that they can get, a GPU can potentially get my entire hard drive out in about 2 seconds, right? So that's a pretty good growth. But if you look at the flops, the computation they could do. About 2006 is about 300, but 2014 is 3900. So there's about 10 times growth. Whereas the memory grew only like 3 times. So the result is that at about 12 years ago, you can compute 16 times per memory fetch. Today, you can compute over 70 times per memory fetch. So this means that you fetch one memory and you're waiting for 70 clocks before you can fetch the next one. So this is a big problem. This is a big problem. So to address this problem, right? This is one of the potential solutions, which was devised by one of our, I think, Professor Kong, right? He's actually born in Taiwan, and he's a professor in Harvard and CNU and all these places. He invented something called systolic array, which involves processors stealing data from the neighborhood. Okay? So this is a bit like, I can give you some pen up, right? And then you can pass it to your neighbor so that I don't have to walk to each different desk and pen it to you, right? So you're just getting data or whatever data from your neighbor. Right? So if you look at this big figure here, interesting thing is that you have as many connections as you have processes. Even though you only have the square root of the number of connections compared to your processor. So let me say this again. You have, in this case, 16 processes. Take the square root of 16, you have 4 input and 4 output, right? So your total bandwidth is the square root of the number of processes you have. But the total internal bandwidth is equal to the number of processes. Okay, so that's important because in each cycle, you can get the data from here to here to here. It takes a few clocks to get here, but I can process something a bit later. Right? I don't have to process it now, right? You can get the data here, and then once you're done with the data, give it to me, right? And I can keep getting the data to my neighbor until like this guy gets it, right? I may be getting the data a bit later, but then it's fine. I can wait. We can just skew the processing, okay? Now, if you do this thing, if you say, I'm not going to use floating point, I'm just going to use fixed point ALU, this becomes like 4 times more, right? And then you have your local data share, and then you have really, really big RAM, a simple but big RAM on the chip, right? That basically is the architecture for Google's GPU, right? They have a paper in ISCA 2017, so it's fairly new. Last year, around June, so you can go and read about this paper. What they did is that they built that chip into a form factor that looks like hard drive. Okay, so this is like hard drive, and then you can plug this in into the SATA interface on the server, and then you can do AI computation. Right? So this is mostly for inferencing, which means that they are not designed for training the neural networks. Because when you're training network, you're going to need floating point. But this guy doesn't have floating point. He only has fixed point. So you can use it for production, like inferencing, but not for training. Now, if you look at the performance, it's really, really high. 92 tetraflops. A lot of computation. So anyways, it's designed for data centers, right? On the servers, not on your desktop, not on your laptop. And these are the primary workloads. So perceptrons and TNN, so image recognition. These are the one, the kind of network that's being used for like Google Photos, right? And then you have LSTM, which is for conversation like Google Home, that kind of application. So these are the three primary workloads that they optimize for. Here's the paper. If you look at it, so many authors, right? Like everyone in this classroom, you put your name on there, it's about the same number of authors. That's an easy way to get your paper legs up. Anyway, but you can look at all the first few are the ones who have the biggest contribution, and then it's alphabetical, A, B, C, D. So you guys, whose name is Agrawal, you know, gets better authorship than these ones. But I think these are the primary authors, the first four. And then, these are pictures from the paper. It looks just about exactly the same as what I drew earlier. It's got the input and there's output, And if you want to add something, just keep passing it down until it gets added. Okay, so there's an accumulator here that adds partial sum into here. Okay, so this is a very good machine for matrix multiplication. And as we know, everything is about matrix multiplication, right? So if you build a fast matrix multiplication machine, you can do anything, right? So that's what they did. And this core is here, right? These are all these units. There are 64,000 units of these, right? So they're arranged into 256 by 256 configuration, and the buffer goes from here and then accumulates here. And then the rest of the stuff are the controller stuff. And then there's external memory ports, and then there's something that talks to the CPU, and there's I/O and CIE, things like that. Okay. I'm gonna skip the raw performance number here, but anyways, this is very fast compared to GPU. So why is TPU faster, right? First, math is way faster because you're on the qubits in that. Second, internal memory throughput is way higher, right? Because you can steal data from your neighbor. Finally, a lot of chip on chip memory. So a lot of memory on the chip. And that means that you're using less power because you're getting data directly from the chip instead of getting data from here. Right? So this is like getting data from here, like for example, you get data from Taipei. And from here, it's like you're getting data from Mumbai. Right? It's really, really far. So in terms of power usage, if you get data from within the chip, it's way more efficient. Okay? So this is kind of the reason why this chip is faster. And plus that they don't have the service, right? And so they really don't have a lot of software between the operating system and the device, okay? So again, these are the two companies and their products and their research that we're talking about. And that's sort of the analogy we had earlier, except that GPU is about like this, right? You have people who's lining up to get transported into the car. And here you have people who is being transported into the car, except you can jump ship. You can get data from your neighbors, basically. And the other things that we can talk about is Google's product is of limited production. They're producing them for their own purposes. Right? They're not going to sell them to Facebook, for example, to be defeating the purpose, or Microsoft. But NVIDIA is making these for our people, so that's one of the differences. You can just buy them, whereas for Google's product, you can buy them. This is perhaps the biggest difference in that Google's product is designed for inference, whereas NVIDIA's product is being designed for training and inference. Recently, they have created product just for training only, so that their floating point becomes faster. But anyways, I think they're actually on par now in terms of performance. Now, the final thing is that you can only run TensorFlow on this guy, whereas you can run CUDA, OpenGL on the NVIDIA processes. Okay. So that's about what I want to talk about today. So any questions? Yeah.
So I assume that you know that inside CUDA there is OpenCL.
Yeah.
So what are your thoughts about OpenCL and so on?
It's dying, isn't it?
Huh?
It's dying, right? It's dying.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I think it's dying. To paraphrase, OpenCL is an open standard for CUDA basically. But not that many people kind of support it well enough. And internally, OpenCL is implemented on top of CUDA anyways, right? So I think the problem is that not that many companies make good parallel processes. So it's easier to just use CUDA. So you can go and buy an AMD processor, and they're just not, the ecosystem just isn't like that. That's one thing. And the other thing is that people are actually using frameworks, right? So frameworks basically works on, frameworks are in parallel of like OpenCL. So in NVIDIA, they will just implement the framework primitive with CUDA, whereas some other companies do things differently. But it's kind of done.
In the picture about imaginary challenge, you show that the error rate of the image recognition is decreased every year. But I think it's not decreased because the using of GPU, it is just decreased because in 2012, mm-hmm. Jeff Hinton from California,
yeah.
He started using deep learning to do the image recognition.
Yeah.
So, I mean, even without GPU, we can still we can still get the lowest error rate, right?
Yeah, you would just miss the deadline, right? That's the problem. Okay, so I have a super algorithm, and it's going to take me a year to run. Right, so in terms of designing algorithm, it just wasn't fast enough to use GPUs. So these are the number of people who are using GPUs, right? So it's a bit like, okay, I have my calculator. I can theoretically build a neural network with my calculator, but it's not going to work because it's just too slow, right? Same thing with this, right? You just can't run neural network on CPU in terms of training. It's just going to take too much time. So these networks become more and more complicated. I think the size of network at least grew like 3 times every year, over the year.